We're going to talk about basic theory of vibrations. Again, this course is not aiming to teach you completely what vibrations mean. So, if you have further questions about vibrations, please feel free to stop by my office, email me, set up an office time. I can suggest reference book that can help you with understanding vibrations in detail. I presume everybody knows what the word vibrations mean, and you all have experienced vibrations when you were driving a car. Maybe you had an experience with an earthquake or even with a heavy machinery that you used. So I'm not going to go into definition of vibrations. In practical, in real life, there are two types of vibrations. They're called as free vibration and forced vibration. Free vibrations occur when you have an initial force, and after that you don't supply it with any additional force. Forced vibration is the one that occurs when you have a constant input of force to your vibrating body. Okay, examples of free vibration. If you have a cantilever beam, you press on the end of the cantilever beam and release it. It starts vibrating and slowly it decays over time. If you keep on applying this force to that cantilever beam after a certain amount of time, then it becomes a forced vibration. So if we look at free vibrations, my goal here is to establish the theory of how free vibrations are characterized. If I have a small mass that is attached to a wall, I'm going to reference this mass, and this is my x-axis, and the motion is only along the x-axis. The mass is going to move to the right. It's called positive x. If it moves to the left, it's negative x. It's attached to a wall. It's fixed on one end, and I'm assuming the attachment has some stiffness k. Okay. If I consider this system, if I apply Newton's laws, that summation of forces is zero, what I get is that negative kx is equal to mx double dot. The mx double dot is essentially the mass times acceleration, and negative kx is the force that is generated in the spring. If I express this, so if I rewrite this, mx double dot plus kx is equal to zero. If I have to write it only in terms of x plus k over m, x is equal to zero, where x double dot, okay, is d square x over dt square. That's the acceleration term. So I can rewrite this as d square x over dt square plus omega square or omega n square x is equal to zero, where my omega n is the square root of the term k over m. Okay, this is the term that's mostly called as natural frequency of my vibrating object. Okay, that's the governing differential equation for this system that I have drawn on the left side. So this is my governing differential equation. This describes how this x is going to be with respect to time. Okay, that's the goal of vibration theory. You want to explain to people what this vibrational motion is going to be. Okay, so if I solve this governing differential equation, which is a second order linear differential equation, the solution to my governing differential equation is given by x is equal to a sine omega n t plus b cosine omega n t. Okay, how did I arrive at the solution? This is from your basic math course where you try to solve a second order linear differential equation, and you might have to revise that basic math for engineering that you did, but this is the solution that you arrive at for x when you solve that governing differential equation. We can rewrite this as the single constant a naught and write sine and cosine as the single function sine omega n t plus phi. Okay, so how does the solution look like? So if this is my x and this is my t, the time, this may look like a sine wave that I wrote up there, and the phi is called my phase of vibration. Essentially, it describes the time it takes to reach when my time is equal to zero. Whatever is the phase lag that is in my wave, and going from this peak to this peak, from here to here, is called my one cycle. This is one cycle of vibration, and that is called as time period. Okay, so we have a relationship between time period and the natural frequency that is given by my omega n is equal to 2 pi over my time period tau. Okay. If I look in the x-axis, the peak value of my x that I'm obtaining in my vibration is my amplitude a naught. So the key parameters that the solution gives me is, what is the amplitude of my vibration? What is the time period of my vibration? What is the phase or phase lag of my vibration? And finally, what is the natural frequency of my vibration? So if I look into units, the amplitude has the units of length. If it's meter or centimeters or millimeters, that's how much they move. So that's in units of length. The time period is in units of time, seconds. The phase, again, we can mention it in time because it's the x-axis that you have there. And natural frequency is 1 over time, which is usually mentioned as hertz. Okay. So that's the most common unit. They call it 1 over time, or sometimes it's also given as radians per second. Okay. Because there is a 2 pi on top. So they can sometimes be referred to as cyclic frequency in radians per second. So all I have done here is establish the basic for you. If I have a body of mass m that is connected to a wall by some connector with a stiffness k, and if I pull the mass and I leave it, it's going to vibrate along the line of x-axis. How do I arrive or try to explain how that motion will occur? I use Newton's laws. I write down that force balance exists. So the force from the spring balances the mass times the acceleration. And I get a governing differential equation, which I can solve quite straightforward. And this is my solution to that governing differential equation. The key parts of the solutions are the amplitude A naught, the natural frequency omega n, the phase angle, or the phase that is given to me over there.